All right. Hello, Fortina's brothers and sisters. Welcome back to Ministry Revealed. It is March 9th, 2024. And brothers and sisters, we, are going to have some fun tonight. You know, I know that the last video was pretty deep and heavy, and it's a lot to take in. You know, watch it in parts, watch it in pieces. But man, is it ever revealing. It's, you know, I'm pretty excited too today because, you know, I've had conversations with a few brothers over the last two, 3 days, and just talking about these things, talking about the understanding of these things that have been revealed, being able to look back on the last 6.5 years, look at the timing of the ministry and us in it. Look at the things that we spoke about 6 years ago, you know, 5.5, 6 years ago. When we were talking about the 5th and the 7th month, and we were talking about Taurus, and we knew about accession and non-accession, one for the house of Israel in Nisan, one for the house of Judah in Tishri. We, you know, talking about Taurus and it being the beginning of the year to the Father, and knowing that the Jews knew it was the beginning of the year, that's where everything started. And going into all of these things, man, going to the open books and seeing what the harvest equaled, And knowing that there's winter wheat and spring wheat, and that winter wheat is the Leah that goes before the Rachel spring wheat, that Leah is the winter wheat harvested in summer, and Leah and Rachel is the spring wheat harvested in fall, and being able to track and to see how the Jews have been using Rachel and carrying her from spring from the fall into the spring, and using that to the count of the Feast of Weeks, and to see how all this has been twisted up, and all of these things that we've studied, that we've learned, that we've dug into for 6.5 years, all of these parts and pieces that we did know were important, were connected, we just didn't fully understand how it would all fit yet. And then we set them aside for a little bit. We talk on them once in a while. And then they come back because more gets revealed and another piece gets added to the puzzle. So much so now that I know, not a thus saith the Lord. I've never had a thus saith the Lord. But I know unequivocally through the revelation of Scripture that in whatever year it's going to happen, it's going to happen at the true Feast of Weeks as we have revealed here, which is truly at the 9th or the 8th of Av. That 8th, 9th of Av, and then the beginning of the 50 days before the 14 years begin. Today, I'm going to go into it even more and flat out prove to you, to kind of bring this excitement that I have after the heaviness of the last one, to reinvigorate, if you will, the truth, the understanding, the unequivocal understanding that when the tribulation begins, not the pre-trib and the 50 days, we've been very clear. That's what I just said. It's not a thus saith the Lord, but it is an absolute revelation of understanding from Scripture. Don't forget, we got Isaiah into the mix, right? We were looking at Luke in order, Luke chapter 2, and Jesus' birth as the 40 days of the Son of Man, white horse rider. And then we get to Isaiah 9, and we see for unto us a child is born. And then we couldn't quite figure it out because how does it fit at that point? How do we account for these things with the sun being 2 months off? We couldn't until we got the revelation that was fulfilled from Isaiah 9 in the is being fulfilled in Matthew 4. And we saw that it was when John was in prison, and we knew from studies from years prior that John was in prison about 2 months after Jesus was baptized. And it all is making sense. It all is in order. It's so powerful. And I've been having these conversations lately that I don't even kind of think maybe it's going to happen earlier or later. I'm not saying I know the exact hour. But for those of you who don't realize that there's differences in the Gospels and that Luke's Gospel says nothing about his discourse about not knowing the day and hour, but that we just wouldn't maybe know the hour. Well, we've got the day. We know, depending on where you live, on what part of the world you live in, within, say, a 24, 48 hour period. It's been revealed. We've got it. The only understanding now is, can we understand this year? How can we really know Feast of Trumpets? Well, we have talked on Feast of Trumpets and proven that when the 50 days of the above portion is over, it's going to begin at the Feast of Trumpets. We know at the end of 6 years of seals, it's the Feast of Trumpets. At the end of 13 years, which is the end of the sixth year of trumpets, it's going to be the Feast of Trumpets. And I'm going to so flat out prove it to you by the end of this that you cannot, you could say whatever you want, but you're going to have to deny the evidence that's revealed, just like we did with the 50 days over all of these years and all of the pieces that have proven it. It's the same thing with understanding that when the 14 years begins, so the 50 days comes pre-trib, 50 days before, we got the events that take place, and then at the Feast of Trumpets, the attack on Jerusalem, Jerusalem is destroyed, it's the beginning of the Red Horse Rider, that is the beginning of the 14 years, and we can prove, as you're going to see here tonight even more, prove it unequivocally, that the 14 years beginning at the Red Horse Rider begins at the day and hour no one knows. And when the 13 years are over, and then the Lord Messiah is here for that final year of trumpets for the judgment with Satan and everything else, I'm going to prove that it's from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, and then prove that the Jubilee is after it. We've talked on many of these things. We've shown these things. But now I'm going to lay it all out, that we can see it, we can understand it. We've known it from when Christ made the conversation he had in Luke chapter 4. We'll touch on that a little bit as well. It is unequivocal that it goes from the fifth month on the Hebrew calendar, fasting and mourning, to the first of Tishri. We have our 50 days there. It begins with the pre-trib, and at the Red Horse Rider, the 14 years begin unequivocally, revealed from Scripture, that it will go in the Hebrew calendar, Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, and the 14 years will start at the Feast of Trumpets, and it will end at the Feast of Trumpets. And we're going to prove, as we've already done it before, where these other events within it, prove it out, and right to the end, where the Hebrew wedding then takes place. The Gentile wedding, as we know, is the pre-trib. The Hebrew wedding is at the end of tribulation. And I'm going to show it to you. I'm going to show some video clips of a video I shared a few times, a couple or so years ago, to show clips from it, because it is so fantastic. Even though the pastor who teaches so well on it doesn't understand where he's talking about, you guys know, if you've been around for a while, what I'm saying. But that video is so revealing to the entirety of Revelation. It's absolutely astronomical, and the guy speaking it doesn't even realize that he's talking about post-trib, and even the years that he gives are the revelation of ministry revealed, but he's unaware of it because he's looking at that final year like the whole world does. And then I'm going to prove it even more with a little clip that was shared from Jonathan Kahn. So when we get into this, and as I get going, we're going to start by looking at something to see, is this really going to be the year? You see, I'm not able to say, oh, absolutely, this is 100% the year. I will absolutely 100% tell you, we know it's from the fifth and the seventh month. I absolutely know the Red Horse Rider begins the 14 years and it starts at the Feast of Trumpets. I know it. I know it unequivocally. It's revealed. I'm not blowing smoke. I'm not trying to say, whoa, me, oh, yes. Nope. It's revealed from Scripture. And it's all of the years of parts and pieces and the puzzles coming together. We know it. Now we also want to be able to see, is within this, as it all comes together, is it really going to be 2024? And for that, even though what I'm going to show you, I'm still not going to say it's unequivocal, but as you see parts of things that we've revealed in the past and we add it to things that we haven't looked at in a while, which is what's been happening lately, we're going to be able to see that if it's not this year, before the Feast of Trumpets and the 50 days before, I'm going to be really scratching my head. You know, God's timing is God's timing. But he gave us his book for a reason. For many reasons. And in the time of the end, a group of people were going to be diligently seeking the truths of the literal interpretation of these things. And that's what's been happening. It's been happening, and we can prove it. So when we put all of these things together, are we really seeing 2024? Because I'm going to put forward, as you see this, I don't see. Like anything, though, is it possible that we just haven't yet been revealed something that it can go another year, 2 years, 5 years, whatever? Of course, that's always a possibility. So that's why I won't say unequivocally in relation to it being 2024. But oh my goodness, I have never been able to be more unequivocally able to almost say that for 2024 than what we're going to understand tonight. And it's parts and pieces that we've understood the whole way through. Scripture tells us. Scripture gives us a count. And we've understood in part how to count it. And then we had to grow on it a bit more. And then, you know, we were a little bit too early. But we have to understand how to count it. And when you understand, as you're going to see in this count, that it can't go another year. From everything I've understood, for those that have been following me and don't just think, oh, this guy's just nuts. From those who really understand, have been following, you're going to see for yourselves. There's just no way, based on what the scriptures give us, that we can go one more year. I just haven't found it, and we have combed from Genesis 1 to the end of Revelation 22, and there are places in scripture that give us these details. And one more year doesn't line up to any of it. In fact, it even seemed like this year that we're in, from Feast of Trumpets 23 to Feast of Trumpets 2024, it almost didn't seem like this could actually be true. Until you understand something that we've taught on. Until we bring it back to another piece of scripture. And another piece of scripture. That it all starts to say, oh my goodness, we had better have our houses in order, because this is game on. This is game on. We're what? About 5 months away? Right? Almost just a little shy of, just a little over 5 months. It is game on. It is time to get our houses in order. It is time to diligently continue to seek him and to start seeking him more if you haven't. To put away those things that cause you to sin. To be strengthened and draw closer and closer to him. To be more loving, repentant. Am I saying we're going to be perfect? Am I saying these are the things that are going to make you accounted worthy? No. But it's going to be the evidence to people around you of Christ in you and the Spirit working in you. That we are making a point of trying to be more like Christ. Knowing that it is at the door, that the game is on. Okay? Let me start by having my sip of coffee. I say, let me start. There you go. One of my 14-minute openers. How about that, right? it's the excitement, man. I'm just feeling it. Because it's so, if people really take the time, for those who haven't quite done it, and just really seek these things out, it's there. It's revealed. So, you know, what I want to do here first is I want to acknowledge some people too. Just a quick in passing, like our brother, Uncle Jimmy, who takes care of our Facebook page. He manages all that and posts our videos, and I just want to say I'm grateful and I thank him for that. We have also Trisha, who does our posts for us on our videos, on our Twitter feed. And we have our brother, Jimmy Luttrell, who does our website that you can click on right here. When you go there, you can join us in the forum. We have a forum there's a program software that he actually helped implement and set up for us on the website. And we've got 1,200 and so people registered in there, all for free, like-minded brothers and sisters from all over the earth that are diligently seeking, reaching others, holding Bible studies, having outreaches, all sorts of things going on. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. We are truly reaching people together as a group in Christ, diligently seeking him in such a wonderful day and hour. So I thank all of those guys, and I thank all of the brothers and sisters in the ministry that are praying for each other, that are supporting each other, that are helping support the ministry here and in Uganda. Man, it's an honor. It's such a blessing. And, you know, I was talking with my wife today about something, and she's like, well, you realize this is what you're going to be doing the rest of your life, right? I'm like, yep. You know, so whether this is the end and then we're going to be workers, or whether it's 20 more years or 30 more years or whatever, this is what I'm doing for the rest of my life. So, man, you know, even after 6.5 years, I'm just as excited as I was. I mean, I was more panicky and freaked out when it was starting, but I'm still just as excited with every teaching because I still can't believe it's happening. I still can't believe he's chosen a group of people like us and whoever else he has still to come to receive these revelations and to understand it. Because it all goes back to the Gospels. When you realize the differences within the Gospels, that is when everything begins to open up. You know, again, I was talking with one of our brothers, Robert, yesterday, and a couple of texts today. When you see these differences, and Clive, you know, when we see these differences within the Gospels and we understand them, and we could show that the true revelation of the end of days is 7 years of seals and 7 years of trumpets, and we see how the Jews see the end of days, and we see how the Christians see the end of days, and we see why they butt heads. Yet the revelation through the revealing of the understanding of who the Gospels are speaking to, we can see both of them and intertwine them perfectly together to reveal them both in order. And there's no more butting heads. It is absolutely awe-inspiring. It is so incredible. And it's such an honor. It is such a blessing. We haven't done anything to deserve it. It was just God's will that said, these guys, now's the time. That's it. And we've been diligent. That's it. We've been loving, repentant. And no matter who comes against, sticking to it and sharing it. Because the truth is the truth. So awesome. Let me show you. Look at this. Our brother Steve in Uganda, guys. There he is right there. He just had, so he's from Uganda, as you guys know. I just found out, I was looking at some of the posts in the forum. Like I said, so you can go sign up on the website, click on the forum link, and it's free to sign up. And we support his ministry in Uganda, Ministry Revealed here does. Man, I wish I had a ton of money. You know, if I had a ton of money, this guy would be out every single weekend until we go. He just finished one about a month ago in Uganda with 7 regions coming in, and over 2,500 people showed up. Last year, they got about 700 people. This year, they were expecting 1,400, and they got over 2,500. Then this one here, he just finished yesterday in the Congo. So they went into the stadium area. They had it all planned, all worked out, setups, everything, speakers, to go into this place in the Congo. And they had 3,000 people show up. 3,000 people showed up. That's our brother Steve. See, Uganda border with Congo right here. They got Steve and one of his other brothers got arrested twice by some of the authorities in the Congo, and they ended up getting released. I mean, people were sleeping. They bought a whole bunch of carpets and brought carpets everywhere because we didn't have enough funding to send them this time. And so they had carpets and carpet pieces, and people were sleeping on the carpets with these tarps and stuff over them. Would you do that? My goodness. Could you imagine any of us doing that? And here these guys are, ready, willing to go out no matter what the cost. And these people traveling from everywhere, having a deal with, he said, the first and second day with incredible demonic activity because of all the witchcraft that goes on there. Incredible. So hats off to our brother Steve Lipsy in Uganda as well. You're doing such an incredible job, brother. I'm so grateful. I'm honored to be a part of it, for us to be able to help you out and to do what we can and to share understanding and to help you grow in reaching more people first in salvation and then bringing them as they understand their salvation and start to learn the scriptures to then come to the understanding of what's at stake, what's coming, and to be ready and prepared for the time that's at hand. It's an honor. And I'm so grateful. So thank you for all that you do for everybody over there as well. Guys, with that, I want to bring up a comment on this stuff as well. So we know in 2024, everybody's looking to this April 8th sign in the eclipse. There's some incredible things. I had people, one sister had sent me that the eclipse from April that's coming up in April with the one from October of 2023 that helps form the Aleph, but that cross actually goes in a place in Texas called Kerrville. I'd never heard of it before. And Kerrville has there's this whole Jesus section of it. And I was looking like on Travelocity or something like that. It's in the top 10 travel destinations on planet Earth. What? Yep. It's in the top 10 travel destinations on Earth. And it's Kerrville, Texas. And the totality of the eclipse where that X forms, that's one of the X's, not the one further up from 2017, but the one from this April and the one from last 2023 October. It's in Kerrville, Texas. And there's a cross there. Wouldn't you believe it? Wouldn't you know it? There is a cross. It's like this hollowed out, just metal frames cross and all sorts of things there. It's fantastic. It's beautiful to see. The guy was inspired to build the cross 77 feet, 7 inches. I love it. 77 feet, 7 inches. Sound familiar? What do we talk about it like? It's like the seven easy years, comma, seven of seals, seven of trumpets. Jews go right to left, so you've got 7, 7, 7. 77 feet, 7 inches. I just thought that was fantastic. So I find that interesting that that does cross there. What does it mean? What does it mean that it will connect with the one from 2017 as well and form an Aleph? Well, this is a speculation on my end, and the speculation is just like Israel has been in battle in a war since October of last year. That war will continue, but I believe what's happening in that war is that the Lord has been using it to ready his people, to have them cry out to him in repentance, to turn and to come to him in obedience. That's what I think is being prepared and them being readied. So when I look at this event here coming in April that kind of completes it all, am I expecting it to be the pre-trib? No, absolutely not. What am I expecting? Well, it might just be another sign, although being is so close that we are, that by this time in April, we're only about 4 months away, I think it may very well be something more than just another solar sign. It may very well be that there's an event, as people have said, you know, it's going up the New Madrid fault line. Is it possible that there's some big shaking? Not such a massive, massive one that rips America apart, but a big enough shaking that the country stops a lot of its division and comes together and starts crying out to the Lord, starts seeking the Lord more, people lifting each other up a little bit more. Is that a possibility? I think it's possible. Am I saying it's going to be? No, as I said, it's a speculation. Because if nothing happens here, the thing is if it's a week, 2 weeks later, a month later, it doesn't have any effect to why all of these people everywhere are looking up at this, whether they're Christian or not. So it would have to be something right in the time frame of it, in my opinion, for people to recognize that it was a sign and the Lord now making this happen, allowing this to happen so that his people can be prepared. So you've got Israel with Jerusalem, Judah, and you've got Israel as the church being prepared, as America being the main player. So I think it is possible, seeing what's already going on over in Israel, that maybe this is a thing now that will be the thing to help prepare America. Am I saying it is? No, I'm saying I wonder if it's maybe a possibility. So definitely all eyes, which I'm sure they already are for everybody, to be peeled and to have an understanding that if something happens at this time, oh man, you want to talk about being ready, being so excited we won't be able to sleep, we'll be jumping out of our shoes. Man, start declaring to everybody if something happens at this time, that the time truly is at hand. What else am I expecting? Well, here's the other thing. We know that Israel, at the beginning of the 50 days, which is August 13th on the 9th of Av, after the pre-trib happens on the 12th, that Israel is going to be attacked by Iran. Iran will attack and destroy Haifa and Tel Aviv. We know from that there's going to be a seven-day war that's going to take place. It'll last, I shouldn't say 7 days, but it'll last about a week before the Son of Man comes and begins his 40 days within those 50 days that begin here. And then at the end of those 50, we know on the day and hour no one knows that Jerusalem will be attacked by Syria and those with Syria, and that will be the Red Horse Rider beginning of the 14 years. So what can we maybe expect also before the pre-trib? Well, we have a video, if you guys remember this video from 2010, right? This Anglo-Saxon mission one, where they've been trying to get Israel to attack Iran for decades. So it may be possible that, you see, as Israel is so fed up and the world's trying to get it to settle down and be peace and give the Palestinians some of their land, you see, the Jews know that the Muslims aren't trying to make a deal with them. The Muslims want them out of Jerusalem. There is no settling this. And so what's going to happen is, it's most likely that Israel, as it continues to chase down Hamas, it's most likely that sometime soon we'll see maybe a strike from Israel in Iran. Not the actual event yet, but something much more sustained in Iran itself, that Iran now starts preparing and things really heat up. We may see that before the pre-trib of August 12th. So I'm not saying, you know, a lot of people ask me, and this is why I'm bringing it up, because many people ask me, what are we going to see? I'm just waiting for that event, I hear. Or people say, you know, what is that one event that we're going to see that we could really know that this is it? Well, I've said it to many people who have asked, I don't know of one. You know, might this be something? I think it's worth putting it out in advance that it may be some sort of weather-related earthquake event that the Lord allows to shake the people up so that they repent and cry out to him, just like they do with every major disaster. And then, of course, we've got Israel and Iran, that as it turns away over time a little bit more from Hezbollah, that Iran now becomes the target, because Netanyahu's not going to let go. He knows that it was Hezbollah through Iran, and he's going to continue to bring it. So how much further in advance might we see an attack from Israel on Iran? Because I don't think Iran is going to do it first. I think it's going to be Israel that's going to do it, which is what the those behind the curtain have been trying to set up for years, for decades. It may be that it's Israel that makes an attack on Iran. And then before Iran does its strike on Haifa and Tel Aviv, we know the pre-trib is going to happen. So we also know that the stone's throw, the meteor breaking up and coming, is going to be in this time. But are we necessarily going to see it? We may see it, but it won't land while the pre-trib is here. So, you know, I'm bringing it up because a lot of people want to know, what might we see between now and 5 months from now? Is there something that the Lord can give us, or that the Lord would give us, that we can point to and say, oh my goodness, game on? That we could really point to and understand. So those are two things that I'm pointing out to you as possibility. An event around this solar eclipse, and or an event with Israel against Iran. Okay? And Israel being the one to attack Iran first. If that happens, one of those two happen, I think go declare it in the streets all you want, because the time will be at hand. So now let's really dig into this. And actually, did you guys think I wasn't going to say it? Oh, come on. Look at how late it is. I'll just make it real quick. For anybody that's new to the ministry, come over here to this playlist. Click on this one right here, the Revealed End Time Study Notes Series, or go to ministryrevealed.com, click on the Intro Series tab, and watch the first four videos. In here, watch the first four videos. You're going to begin to understand things that if you've ever studied your scriptures, you will have had questions for. How is it that all these things in tribulation are going to take place in 7 years? Well, the answer is they're not. How are these things that are in the discourses and within the synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, why are there different stories within the same events? You're going to understand that here for the first time in your life if you're new. And there's a 22-minute intro video that begins to give you the understanding of what's coming in the next three. The second video is a 30-minute intro to these differences within the Gospels and what they reveal, which is all prophetic. You come to find out that Matthew, Mark, Luke, in the end of days, it's the first will be last, the last will be first. It goes Luke pre-trib, Mark mid-trib, Matthew post-trib. Oh my goodness, what did he say? That's right. There's a reason why everybody can stand on pre, mid, or post in their point of view using scripture. They're all true, but they don't happen over a 7-year period. And that's what you're also going to come to understand when you realize the differences in the discourses and within the gospels and the story that they reveal. You're going to see Jesus arrayed in a gorgeous robe, which means white, radiant, beautiful. In Luke, in Mark, he was arrayed in purple. In Matthew, he was arrayed in scarlet. And those are both tribulation colors. You see? Because there's a Gentile wedding pre-trib first. And then there's a post-trib Jewish wedding, which is going to be more of the focus later on. And you're going to see it. We know that the pre-trib bride of Christ, the pre-trib will happen right in here if it's 2024. And when it happens, it is a 7-day wedding. This is the Gentile wedding that is going to take place. And then what we're going to talk about, and that's why you see, if you're new, this is why you see a wedding in Luke's gospel. In Luke chapter 14, you see a conversation. Let's go to it real quick. In Luke chapter 14, you read about this wedding taking place. And the people that are invited, and you're not to go sit down in the highest room, but sit in the lowest room. It's a completely different wedding story being mentioned than the one we get in Matthew, I think, 20 or 22. It's a completely different story. Yet, people will always go to the Matthew one. And they'll maybe look at the Luke one to try to get little extra tidbits and say, connect it to the Matthew one. But it's a different storyline. And it's purposed. It's purposed for the groups of people. And that's why Mark doesn't have a wedding. There is no wedding story in Mark's gospel. Do you know that only in Luke's gospel, where you have the wedding, then you have a great banquet after the wedding? When you go to Matthew's, it's just a parable of the wedding, but no great banquet. We understand why. We've taught on it here. We know that when the pre-trib goes, and then you've got the seven-day wedding, when he returns, and the Son of Man is here as the prophet as Jonah was, and he's here for 40 days, the first thing he's going to do is have a banquet with the group of people that should have been part of the pre-trib wedding, but he chose to remain and to use as his servants to follow him during the 40 days and then serve him during seals. He's going to have a banquet with them first that he said he would. We know it because the scriptures have said it. It's in Luke chapter 4 in typology. It's in Luke chapter 12. But when you go to Matthew's, it's a different wedding story. And the reason it's a different wedding story is because the first one is the Luke Gentile one, and the Matthew one at the end, which we're going to talk about later today, is the one that is the post-trib Hebrew wedding. And you're going to see where it is. I'm not going to make anything up. I never make anything up. I show it to you from scriptures, and I'll even use other people's teachings for the evidence and them not even really understanding what it is they're saying for what it equals. They think it means pre-trib. And yet the timing of it, they don't understand. It's beautiful when you see it and you understand it. So as you go into these things and you see these differences in the Gospels, so much will begin to open. The third video, which is another 30-minute intro, is about the revelation of the 14 years in a period called above. You will realize for yourself, it is 100% absolutely, positively, unequivocal that it is 14 years in a period called above, and that period called above is 50 days. You're going to see it with your own eyes. You'll see it revealed in the revelation of the discourses after you go through those four videos. And then when you get to the fourth video, it's a big one called It's All Because of Matthew. And why? Because everybody for hundreds of years from seminaries and everywhere all learned their foundational gospel teachings from the book of Matthew. So everything they've looked at has a perspective of Matthew, which is only 7 years. Because they've not understood who Mark is speaking to, the church has missed that there's 7 years of seals. And so when they go to seals, when they go to trumpets, they either mash it together, they sandwich it together, and they mix it all up, and it makes no sense. Oh, they've made it seem like it kind of sounds pretty good, but it's all confused. I promise you here, you will begin to understand the tribulation, the revelation of the end of years, as you have never, ever witnessed it before. It's that fantastic. It'll be worth every moment of your time. A 22-minute, a 30-minute, 30-minute, and then a 2-hour and 45-minute video explaining how it was all missed. Worth every moment of your time, I promise. So now let's get into the crux of what we're talking about here today. And this, we can thank our, we'll thank our brother Roy for this one, because this had been set aside for a long time now. You know, I hadn't looked at it for, really quite a while. And one of the reasons was because of how the count appeared. Well, we have to understand something, and it's something we knew before. And there's a reason why last year we were excited for it to be last year, and why many others were looking at it to be last year as well. And it had to only be that it could go from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets. So from Feast of Trumpets 2022 to Feast of Trumpets 2023, it seemed like the very plausible time frame. And there was reason for it. And one of the things that people were pointing to was Abraham. Last year, I never really pointed to it because I figured we were able to show it just from when Israel came into the land based on another piece of scripture in Leviticus that we'll get to in a little bit. But when we understand what and apply what we've understood from those previous teachings, it all makes sense. You're going to see why, when we see this in the eyes of Scripture, why I don't believe we can go another year. We are at the limit. We are at the maxed out limit in the Feast of Trumpets 2023, the Feast of Trumpets 2024, on every possible scenario way of counting it that the Scriptures have told us. You see, when you go to this chart here, we showed this from 1948 to 1949 and how the count actually played out. But we couldn't understand to be able to do it from Israel anymore. And the reason we couldn't understand was we said, well, if we apply it to Jerusalem, because they didn't actually get Jerusalem in 1948. And if we follow the storyline of when they first received a portion of Jerusalem in 1950, well, then we could do that count. And the reason we applied it was twofold. One, we couldn't, how were we going to count this in relation to Israel when they came into the land? It wasn't making sense. Something was missing. Well, then what happens is that we thought, well, wait a second. God's land isn't all of Israel. It's Jerusalem. And so when we do this count based on when they finally got a portion of Jerusalem, then we could say, ah, there we go. Let's move forward with this count. And when we did, we knew where to do this count, and we end up with the 70 years of Israel from Feast of Trumpets 2023 to Feast of Trumpets 2024, making us in the seventh year right now, which it is. It's a Sabbath year. It's a Shemitah year. But I want to bring more to the table with this because it's something that others have talked about in the past. But you see, how does it make sense if Israel is in their 76th year? Ha, huh. There's the problem, isn't there? How is it that if Israel is 76 this year, and they're in their 76th, that makes it a problem? Because there is no scripture about 76, 77, 78. There's no scripture that can give this count beyond 75. We have it from Abraham, which we haven't covered in a long time, and really haven't because of another place we have in Leviticus. But I think it's time to bring it to the table. Because even though we have this count with Jerusalem, what if we count it with Abraham and him coming into the land? So we've covered this in the past. If you remember Genesis 11, chapter 26, we see that Terah, who's Abraham's dad, had Abraham. And we know Abraham is connected to High Father because it's like to the Jewish people, he represents Judah. And then what do we have? Remember this fantastic find with Mike from Interrupts 165 and Amish and those guys? And they find Nahor. And Nahor means snorer. So if this is Judah or the Gospel of Matthew, and Mark is to the sleeping church that's left behind that's not ready, to the world, right? The house of Israel, the Gentiles grafted in, and it's the unprepared church. Snorer. It's fantastic. And then we have the third one, the youngest, who is like Luke, and this one's connected to Mountaineer, right? That's pretty, it was very interesting for us here in this ministry. I'm not saying it's only our ministry, but within the ministry, we call ourselves 14ers because of the revelation of 14 years and found out that there were original 14ers at the time of Christ. Like after his time, these guys were called the 14ers. And they did it because of days, and here we were, a group of 14ers, calling ourselves 14ers because of years. And in prophecy, days become years. There's this prophetic conversion. And everybody knows about it. We've taught on it several times. And so it was really wild to see this as Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And Luke being first, and here's the mountaineer. And we found out that there's a group of people that climb mountains that are called 14,000 foot mountains throughout America, and they call themselves 14ers. And what are they? Mountaineers. 14ers who are mountaineers. It was so wild to grasp this, because we saw Luke's group in it, Mark's group in it, and Matthew's group in it. And then what did we find out? Well, the first one to die is Haran. Haran dies first. So whether you want to say it as dying or as a prophetic picture of the Luke group going first, and maybe this dying, because what do we know about this group? Well, the mountaineers, we know from the pre-trib group that's going, we know there's a remnant from the Luke group which are going to remain and stay, which are connected to Smyrna, the group that he's going to have that banquet with when he returns from the wedding that I spoke of earlier. And what's going to happen? They're going to be putting their necks on the line, and some of them shall be put into prison, and some of them will die. It's an incredible connection of things that we've known over the years, and being able to piece it together and to see it, and to see the names. I mean, this stuff is just crazy. And now what happens? They came from the nativity in Ur. And then what happens? So now Haran, or the Luke group, is gone. And there's a group working with the Lord during the 40 days. Even some will die within that time, according to Luke's discourse. Luke's discourse is the above, and it talks about, and some of you they will put to death. So you've even got some dying, and you've got the metaphor or the allegory of like those dying, but being the pre-trib being taken. Now then what happens? Now we go to chapter 12. And in chapter 12, Abraham, get thee out of thy country. In chapter 12, verse 1, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto the land that I will show thee. We see down in verse 4. And Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed Haran. Well, it's interesting with this Haran connection, because if we go to Genesis chapter 29, which is the story of Jacob and the Rachel and Leah, we're seeing the same conversation. Remember the rolled the stone away from the well's mouth, from the well's mouth, from the well's mouth. So this is that well in the mouth of the well. And where was Jacob? It says in verse 4, and Jacob said unto them, my brethren, whence be ye? And they said, of Haran are we. So a group being from Haran. Now there was the place called Haran of the person who was Haran, right? And then it says in verse 5, and he said unto them, know you Laban, the son of Nahor? Part of those being left behind, right? The Snorer church group. And we have this connection to the mouth of the well and all of these things. We saw this even in John chapter 4. We see the woman, the Samaritan woman. We see Jacob's well, the Samaritan woman. We have all of these connections to the Samaritan woman, the woman at the well. And what does Jesus tell her that we just recently shared on? The revelation of what this meant. When John 4:35, Jesus says, say you not, there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest. Behold, I say, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. We now know what that means. We now know it was the difference between the Leah harvest being ready compared to the Rachel one, from winter wheat starting its harvest to spring wheat starting its harvest. One starts its harvest in the spring, in the summer, and the other one is late summer to early fall. We've understood it. He was saying, you guys are busy looking for Rachel. I'm telling you guys, lift up your heads. Leah's going first. And what do we get in the story? Being at the well, like we shared in the video on it. What do we get in the story? We get the Jacob story with the well. We've got Haran there looking for the relative of Nahor. We go to the story of Abraham, and we see that Abraham is now leaving that area of Haran to go to his area, and Haran is dead. Hello, dead or the workers, and what does it say? Abraham was what? Was, meaning he was in his 75th year, okay? He was in his 75th year. So now, what on earth does 75 have to do with the connection to what we're looking to now? Well, watch what happens. We have Abraham. You know, many people have done these counts, and you could see that Abraham's birth, many people show you that it was 1948. Okay? So he was born in 1948. So it not in BC, but if you count from the creation of Adam as day one to when the year was from Adam's creation to Abraham was 1948 years. We all know Israel comes into the land in 1948. Israel comes into the land in 1948, and it was on the 14th of May, 1948. And what would happen is we think that, like everybody else, they were looking last year and counting in an Abraham count. And because it was May 14th, it becomes a number or a particular date, whether they want to look at May 14th or whether they want to say the Hebrew 5th of Iyar, they look at that date and they think that the count is directly related to that date. But we know that's not how it works. And what did we come to understand in this? Well, prior or before going into this in relation to Abraham, we know from Leviticus chapter 19, this was such a huge thing about 3 or 4 years ago. We've been looking at it like crazy, right? Because we were looking at what it said and trying to discern, okay, well, is it 3 years? And then the fourth year, bang, it's given to the Lord. And then we're like, well, is it the fifth year? You know, how did this count? And the thing was, is if we counted from 1948, and if you count from 1948, guess where you end up? You end up last year in 2023. So 75 years would have been completed in 2023 from 1948. So Feast of Trumpets was over. We're now in the 76th year, and the Jews would tell you they're in their 76th year right now since May. We know it doesn't count from this particular date. This is just the date that they came into the land. So what if we apply what the scriptures tell us? This was a big deal piece of scripture to understand, because this count comes before you begin to count 70 years. So let's listen carefully and watch carefully to what it says. Leviticus 19:23. And when you shall come into the land, okay? When you shall come into the land. Okay, that's not hard to figure out. May 14th, 1948. Okay, we all understood that. But then it says, comma and, meaning there's another thing that has to happen when you come into the land. It says, and shall have planted all manner of trees for food. Now listen to this. Then you shall count when you come into the land and have planted trees for food, then shall you count the fruit uncircumcised 3 years. So when they planted, that doesn't begin to count either. Because it's not a random count to a year. There's only two counts, one for the house of Israel and one for the house of Judah. So they came into the land in May of 1948. Okay? May of 1948, they came into the land, but there was another thing that they had to do. So we come to 1949, and in 1949, February 14th, 1949, right here, February 14th, 1949, Ben-Gurion and those guys plant on the date of what's called Tu B'Shavat, which is the new year of trees, which is the planting of trees. What did it say? When you came into the land, May 14th, 1948, and shall have planted all manner of trees, February 14th, 1949, then shall you begin to count. Okay? But this is just when it was planted. It was planted. These trees were being planted. You can start counting, but this isn't the beginning of the year. It's the new year of trees so that you can understand how old trees are. But it's not the beginning of the year. Do you recall what happens? This great find, it wasn't a discovery by us. It was a discovery by two other writers. Thiel was one of them, and there was another guy, but I think this main one is about Thiel. Yeah, Edwin Thiel. And discovered, as we've taught on before, that when you go through the biblical chronology, whether it's kings of Judah compared to kings of Israel and those kingdoms reigning at that time, there would always be 1 year short or 1 year over for the year counts. And it really threw the chronology of scripture off, and people have been rattled for centuries. Well, this guy and another guy, but this guy really brought it to the forefront when he found it, because he realized that when you understood the difference between the house of Israel and the house of Judah, it all ended up in order. So let me read part this paragraph here. However, some of the biblical cross references that I'm at 20 years, Thiel noticed that the cross references given during the long reign of King Uzziah of Judah had a cumulative error of 1 year for each succeeding reign of kings of Israel. The first cross reference resulted in an error of 1 year. The second gave an error of 2 years, the third of three, and so on. He explained this pattern was a result of two different methods of reckoning regnal years, the accession year method and in one, and non-accession year method in the other. Understanding the accession year method, listen to this, if a king died in the middle of a year, the period to the end of that year is called the accession year of a new king. So who's 1 year, which means the first year of that king would begin at the new year. This, what you find out, is the accession year method is what the house of Judah used. So those of you who have been around for a while, you know this. But this is for some newer people. So what is this saying? This is saying that if in 1948, when they came into the land, was it the house of Israel that came into the land? Or was it the house of Judah? Everybody on earth knows it was the house of Judah, right? The house of Israel scattered all over the earth. It's the house of Judah that came into the land. Well, what you find out is the house of Israel counted Nisan as the beginning of the year. But the house of Judah counts Feast of Trumpets, Tishri 1, as the beginning of the year. So what that was saying is that the house of Judah who came into the land in 1948, but still had to plant, and they did it on February 14th, 1949, now the count would begin of the accession, meaning all of this time, all the way until Tishri 1, September 24th, 1949, this now officially, in a biblical historical count, this began year one for the king of Judah, who was, of course, David Ben-Gurion. Yes, he was in before. Yes, he was. They held their elections, right? And he becomes, now remember, he wasn't even the official prime minister. Remember, we shared on this. He was the proxy prime minister until the Jews voted, right? The Jews voted, I think it was January 25th of 1949. David Ben-Gurion still won, but prior to that, he was just the proxy. He was recognized, but it wasn't official until they had their elections. And they have their elections, and then he took over, what was it, March 10th or March 11th of 1949. So even if you want to say that's when they came into the land, well, they should start counting from there. No, because Leviticus, Bible scripture tells us when you come into the land and shall have planted all manner of trees, then shall you count. So what's happening? Not only wasn't he truly the king of Judah, if you will, they had to plant their trees. And after they planted their trees and they had already had their election, planted their trees, and then he takes office on the 10th to the 11th of March of 1949. You remember we shared this a few years ago. It was on the 10th or 11th of 1949 that he tore up the provisional governorship document that he had. He was now officially the king of Judah, okay, or officially the prime minister of Israel. But you see, here is Nisan 1. If he was actually the king of Israel or the prime minister of the house of Israel, then they would have begun their count right here. But he's not. He's the king of Judah. So even though we call it Israel, they're all Jews, according to scripture, and following the count of the kings, the accession format, that means everything from when you come in. So if a king comes in the middle of a year, which is what happened with David Ben-Gurion by March, and there he was now the official king of Judah, then what happened? He's in his accession year, according to scripture, which means right here begins the first year of Israel. And it completely lines up with what scripture said, because you had to come into the land first, you had to plant trees. Now they get their king officially, and then they've got to go to the accession year, precisely as it says the pattern was all throughout scripture. Under the non-accession year, under the non-accession year method, the period to the end of the year would be year one. So if it was really the house of Israel in the land, and David Ben-Gurion officially has become prime minister on the 10th, 11th of March, then that would mean on March 31st of 1949, they would have called this the beginning of his second year. How crazy is that, right? Because he came in right here. So in a non-accession count for the kings of the house of Israel, anything, any king that comes into power prior to, even if it's 2 weeks or whether it's 11 months, all of that or the little amount of it would have been called his first year. And on Nisan 1, 2 weeks later, 3 weeks later, they would have said he's beginning his second year. This is what the house of Israel would have done. But the house of Israel is not in the land. The house of Judah, excuse me, is in the land. So when Ben-Gurion becomes prime minister of the house of Judah, or another term is the king of Judah, and he came in the middle of the year, because they go from trumpets to trumpets, it means all of these months in between to this point were called a session. They were the preparation time. And he wouldn't officially be called the beginning of his first year until September 24th. That is what this tells you. This is what it tells us. Guess what? This is scripture. This is scripture. This was a guy or a couple guys over decades that came to realize how this count was taking place and how there was a mismatch that always threw off the years. These guys discovered what the answer was from scripture. So I'm not making this up. It is all from scripture. And now when we go back to this and we see, there we go. We came into the land. Got it. Planted all manner of trees. Got it. Then you can count. Okay. So now what happens? They planted back in February. He's now beginning year one. So we go to 1950. So 1949, Feast of Trumpets, to 1950, Feast of Trumpets. And we get to the New Year of Trees. The trees here now are 1 year old. So now what is Israel in? What is Jerusalem? What is the house of Judah in? The Jews that are in the land are the house of Judah. They are now what? In their first year from September 1949 until September 12th of 1950 is their first year, which means on February 2nd of 1950, it was the first year complete of the tree planting, but it's in the first year of Israel and the things needed to be complete with their leader and the count from the Feast of Trumpets. This is now in the first year. And look what happens. In the first year, bang, completed first year. Now, September 13th, 1950, they start year two. Go to 1951. And on January 22nd, it's the second year of trees being done, right? It's complete. And it's what? In the second year. We go to October 1st of 1951. And now they start year three. There's the start of year three into 1952. There's February 11th. They've now completed 3 years of trees. That's the third year, right? From 50, right? January, February, 50, 51, and 52. 3 years of trees are now complete, and they're what? In the third year of Israel. And what happens for those 3 years? It said, then shall you count the fruit thereof uncircumcised 3 years. Okay? 3 years. So now we've covered 3 years. We're still in the third year here. And on September 20th, 1952, the fourth year begins. Fourth year begins September 1952 to September 1953. 1953, where is it? January 31st, New Year of Trees. This is the fourth year of the trees, and it's what? In their fourth year. What did scripture say? This very important word right here. Leviticus 19:24. But in the fourth year, all the fruit thereof shall be holy to praise the Lord with all. Fourth year of the trees, in the fourth year, is 1953. Okay? 1953. We get to September, and now what happens? Now the fifth year starts in September 1953. Now it's the start of the fifth year. And in the fifth year, 1953 to 1954, here's your Tuba Shavat. And what does it say? In the fifth year, you shall eat the fruit thereof. So now he's going to allow them to eat the fruit thereof in their fifth year. But the fifth year doesn't end until late September, right? End of September, 1954. What do you think starts from there? You got it. What if we take the calculator and make what I just showed you really easy? And we go back to 1949, okay? Let's make it really simple and go back to 1949. They've planted, they had their elections. They planted the trees. Ben-Gurion now takes official office. And at Tishri 1, September 24th, 1949, what starts? The 5 years and then 70. Right? How old was Abraham? Abraham left in what? And Abraham was 75 years old. Abraham was 75 years old. So what do we know comes first? The count of five. It's five and then 70. So what happens? We count from September 1949, September 24th, 1949. Watch this. September 24th, 1949. We add 5 years and 70, or 75 years. And what do we get? September 24th, 2024. Now, what do we know about 2024? It's not going to be the same September 24th, but it's going to be October 3rd in 2024. Actually, it will be the October 2nd is the last day of the year. That means, according to a biblical scriptural count, October 3rd, Tishri 1, the other eclipse, by the way, there's an eclipse on the 2nd, which is the 3rd in Jerusalem. There's another total solar eclipse. One is on Nisan 1, one is on Tishri 1 this year. How about that, right? So that means that October 3rd, Tishri 1 of 2024 begins what? The 76th year. If I put 76, we go to 2025. Did you see anything that said 76 years? In fact, all we have is a 5 year count with 70. We have it in Leviticus 19. We have it with Abraham's age when he's in his 75th year. When he's in his 75th year, so we got Abraham 75. We've got Leviticus telling 5 and then 70. We know now how to count it because of how it told us to count. But we also know how to count it because of what these guys had discovered decades ago in the accession and non-accession. And we know that scripture told us, like Zechariah, chapter 1 of 14 verses for 14 years, that told us, where is it? Verse 12. How long will you not have mercy on Jerusalem and on the cities of Judah, against which thou hast had indignation these 70 years? Why was this always so important for us? You see, this is something I've spoken about many times over the years. We have been one of the only ministries, if not the only ministry I know of, where we have diligently continued to seek out and understand the 70 years of them coming into the land. We were now able to show it in an Israel count, using also Abraham, and understanding that just because they came into the land, that's not when it began. We were able to show it with them coming into the land and also doing it from a Jerusalem count, which we have on the chart. Do you know that that Jerusalem count and the Israel count that it just showed you and them coming into the land? Do you realize that it's impossible, according to those revelations with scripture, it's impossible for us to go another year? There's no way. There's this 70 coming to an end that begins it all. And we know there's a 70 at the end of 13 years. 70 years is complete. And so what happens? We do the 70 count, and what do we get? We've got the 70 for Israel, but what do we get? 1967 was when they got the rest of Jerusalem. It's not when they came into the land. You don't apply the same count because we've already done that count of when they came into the land. So we've got a 70 coming to an end. And at the end of 13 years of tribulation, which is the end of the sixth year of seals, we've got an end of 70, which is directly lined up with Jeremiah chapter 25 that said when 70 years are complete, it's the year of the treading of the grapes, which is the final year of the wrath of God. So if we've known this and we have proven, this is why Israel coming back into the land was so important. Because just from this alone, being the end of the 70 for Jerusalem, what other 70 are we supposed to use? What other biblical scriptural reference are we to understand that when 70 years comes to an end after 13, as Jeremiah 25 says, that then it's the treading of the grapes of wrath, which is the final 14th year of the Lord after he's returned feet down on the Mount of Olives? There's no other reference point to this. We can't say, it was 1948. Can't say it was 1940. You can't say it was 1968. Can't say it was 1969, 1970. Just like you couldn't say it was 1966 and 1965. This is it. This one was one of the most exciting ones we understood, that when this final 13th year is over and this 70 is over, it leaves one more year in the tribulation, which is the final year of the days of Noah, which is Matthew 24's discourse, final year. But this one, we can now show and understand as well. But we can't go any later. It's the 70 years that start here. And even in Leviticus, There was only a maximum with a count of 5 years there. But the only way you can understand that count is understanding when they came into the land, when they planted, when their leader took authority, when he officially took office, and then realizing that they are the house of Judah, and that the house of Judah doesn't count until trumpets. You're going to see why this is so important, that it was the house of Judah that came back in the land. Of course, it couldn't have been the house of Israel. They're all over the world. They're mixed in all the believers. It had to be the house of Judah. It so much had to be the house of Judah. I'm going to prove it to you, because the end of days is all about going from the Feast of Trumpets to the Feast of Trumpets. All the way through. And this was something that brought us back all the way to around April, May, June of 2018. That when we come to the seventh chapter, which is a picture of the seventh year of seals. And he's saying, when you fasted, everything's past tense, and mourned, past tense, in the fifth and the seventh month. That's the ninth of Av and the Feast of Trumpets, but they observe it on the third day because they don't want to do it on the Feast of Trumpets, the day and hour no one knows, so they made it the third day. But this fasting and mourning was because of the ninth, and this was of the fifth month, and this was because of the one of the first day of the seventh month. And look at what it says, even those 70 years. Do you know the exact number of days from the ninth of Av to right before the Tishri 1, like Elul 29? It's 50 days. The exact thing we've shared and revealed and understood in the above portion since about midish 2018. There is no other option. It's the end of the line. You can't extend. How are you going to extend this? 1, 2, 3, 4 more? It doesn't work. Add to it, as we've said before, the fact that the Revelation 12 sign in 2017 is an exact 7-year warning, which this is the 7 easy years, like Jacob was working for Leah, expecting Rachel, but got Leah. And what happens when Leah has her wedding week? Her wedding week, which is what we say is the first 7 days of the 50, it's called the Feast of Weeks. The Feast of Weeks is one day, but her wedding week is called Shabuah, because it's at the Feast of Weeks, and it's a 7-day wedding that follows. It's the pre-trib and the 7-day wedding. And then it just so happens that the King James Version, the King James Bible, started in 1604, and it was complete in 1611. An exact Sabbath cycle. And without going into all the details again, let's not forget the words Jesus spoke in Luke chapter 4 when he was declaring the Jubilee. He was declaring that what was coming up in 29 from 28 when he was making the declaration, that the Jubilee was at hand. That means it could have only been sometime in 2028 to sometime in 2029. And we know it from the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar being 28 AD and the 16th year of Tiberius Caesar from history records being 29 AD and from coins. Which means Jesus was declaring the Jubilee was at hand. So we began the Jubilee count in 29. Based on the words and the timing of when Jesus was saying it. And it just so happened that as we followed it all the way through, 2038 to 2039 is the Jubilee year. Look at this. What was I just proving? The 70-year count for Israel based on scripture, based on the count of the kings, based on whether it's the house of Israel or the house of Judah, based on them having to come into the land, having to plant, then having their leader, and then having to count from the Feast of Trumpets because they're the house of Judah. And then the easy one was, of course, 1967, not having to do a land count because they were already in the land, and just doing the 70-year count, and it lines up smack dab exactly to Jeremiah 25, when 70 years are done, then it's going to be the treading the grapes of the winepress of the wrath of God, that all those nations that came against him are going to have to drink. So he's going to come and tread them, which is Revelation 19, which is at the return of the Lord, feet down on the Mount of Olives, which is means what? 13 years of tribulation. One final year of destroying the enemy and preparing the world. You're going to want to remember that if you're newer. We're going to cover that in a little bit. So you following what's happening? Yes, we were looking at it back in here like everybody else. Yes, we were looking at it here like everybody else. But what did we know there was? There was this count from when you come in, this gap year count, and 5 years, right? Because of when they came into the land. I'm trying. I know I'm repeating, but I really wanted to sink in that you realize there is no making a forced push to be able to say, oh, well, I guess maybe it's not looking like this year. We're going to have to go Feast of Trumpets 2024. So we're looking at 2025 sometime. You can't. There is no 6 years and then 70. After that gap and then five. From when they came into the land. We're at the limit. We're at the extremities of possibly making an understanding of that count from Leviticus chapter 19. And why is it so important? Because there is a 70 years that are those 70 years from chapter 1 of Zechariah 1 that said these 70 years. Years. There had to have been an understanding of account. Do you understand why? Because if it was simply from 1948, then it should have been around here somewhere. And it wasn't. If it was simply a 5 year count, then it should have been 2022 to 2023. But when you understand these things that we've just gone through, and understand because it's the house of Judah, and understand that these things had to happen before that count, there's only 1 year left. And we're in it. It started at the Feast of Trumpets last year. So not only is this so vitally important for us to have understood, when you connect it with this one, and we know that Matthew's final year is the days of Noah, which equals the 14th year of tribulation, the 7th year of trumpets, when the Lord has returned feet down. And that when that year is done, it has to be a jubilee. And we didn't make this count. This was strictly a count from when Christ declared it, based on the truth of his birth on a Gregorian calendar, 2 BC. Guys, this is what I'm getting at. This is why we need to be so in tune. Oh, we're going to have some bad days. There's going to be some bad times. We have brothers and sisters that are really struggling, that are having health issues, major financial issues. So many things that are going on out there. I get it. I hear about it and I pray for you guys. And I know many of us are. But in it all, we have to keep picking each other up, strengthening each other, and reminding each other that it's really happening. Sometimes that happens, doesn't it? Where it just feels like this, we've talked about it, revealed so much. It's almost like it's a script to an incredible movie. But we got to remind ourselves that it's all real. That we're truly in the midst of it all happening. All of the puzzle parts and pieces over the last year that have been off and not quite fitting are all falling into place. Not falling into the place. They have been put in their place. It's all true. It's all true. We are the final generation, guys. We're living in it right now. And if we're counted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man, you're all going to be a bunch of Enochs. A bunch of Enochs. Never having tasted of death. What kind of glorious blessing is that? To be a group of people, tens of millions, in the final generation, in Christ, spirit-filled, purposed for this time, to not taste death. Or maybe if you're here, maybe if you're here, being prepared, right? Being prepared in this, but before all these things that I was mentioning earlier, that some of you they shall cause to be put to death. We know this, that's part of the above portion, right? This some of you being put to death. We know they're related to the group I was showing earlier in Revelation chapter 2 with Smyrna. They're the same group. Some of you shall be put to prison and tried and put to death. But their glory is the resurrection. They're part of the first resurrection to rule and reign with Christ for the millennial reign. So it's okay, right? Just like it was in Christ's day. He was preparing a group of people. And when he prepared that group of people and he opened up their understanding, that's what Christ is going to do when he comes for these 40 days after he lets this group know. Be ready when I return from the wedding and knock. He's going to complete the story and open up the understanding. Man. It's awesome stuff, guys. So this is what we're seeing. Let's go to Luke's discourse. In Luke's discourse, as we said, when you understand that Luke's discourse, the pre-trib has happened. So this is why in Luke's discourse, we have the story of the coming of the Son of Man. Okay? You got the story of the coming of the Son of Man. There's no abomination of desolation. You have the Son of Man coming, and it says coming on, where is it? Coming on, even though it's the word in, okay? Sorry. It's the word in a single cloud. And in Luke's, it says something much more pleasant, if you will, much easier in Luke 21:34. It says, starting 34 through 36, and take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with the suffering and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares, for as a snare. What come awares? That day. No day and hour, right? So what? So that you're not caught off guard when this day comes. So you can, there's a comprehension of the day here. For as a snare shall it come upon all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Everyone's going to be affected. Watch ye therefore and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. To escape what? Some? Part of it? No. Escape everything that's about to come to pass. And when it comes to pass, it's going to catch the whole world off guard in its snare. But if you're watching, you'll see that day coming, and you can understand it. What happens when you go to Mark's? Okay, so if we recognize this in Luke's, and we see all this, and yet we see here, so what do we have? The end of Luke's discourse is the pre-trib group going before all these things take place. You get it? So you're reading of all of these things taking place in Luke's discourse, and it's telling you to be accounted worthy to escape all of them before it happens. That's the pre-trib, which means the pre-trib, even if we go back to the calendar and we understand if it is 2024 as it's lining up and appearing to be, that would mean that the pre-trib would happen sometime here on the 12th of August, the 8th of Av, depending where you are around the world, okay? And say in this time frame here, and it says that you would escape all these things that shall come to pass, okay? When we go to Luke 21:10, and it says, then he said unto them, nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes in diverse places, and famines and pestilence, and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. Well, what is nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom? That's the Red Horse Rider starting. But listen to what it then says, only in Luke. But before all these. Okay? So before all of this, which means it's got to be during the White Horse Rider time, the pre-trib has just escaped it all. So if the pre-trib escapes it all around the 12th of August this year, they have their seven-day wedding, and then we know that before nation against nation and all this stuff breaks out, nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, that's when they go to war against each other, which is the Red Horse Rider when the great sword is given. We know that this but before is the 40 days of the Son of Man as the White Horse Rider. And so what does it say? But before all these, they shall lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up into synagogues and into prisons. See, it's going to happen real quick. Because there's going to be a group of people in Christ, spirit-filled, with understanding and power and authority being given in it, who are with them. Some of these guys are going to be taken, dragged about. These are some of the workers, right off the bat. This is what I was talking about earlier. Luke 21:16, and you shall be betrayed by both kinfolk and parents, and brethren and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but there shall not a hair of your head perish. In your patience possess you your souls. This is for some of them that are going to die. Which means this is even going to begin as soon as the 40 days start. So why won't it happen during the wedding that's taking place in heaven? Because this remnant worker group is going to be in their homes, probably hunkered down, because the Lord told them to wait when he returns from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they would open to him. So when he comes on the eighth day after the wedding, I think all these people are probably going to be hunkered down in their homes, waiting for the Lord to return to begin his 40 days, knock, and then he'll take them to wherever he's going to have that banquet with. So you will have had that Luke wedding from Luke 14, and then the banquet with that remnant worker group, which is the Luke 24 Smyrna group. That's this group right here. Some of them are dying, but they will also remain during time of seals. The rest of them, and be a part of bringing in the great multitude. Now what happens? We know that Jesus said he's going to be here as Jonah was. Jonah was here to warn of what? Well, here he is, Jesus coming to warn Jerusalem. So he says here in Luke 21:20, and when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. And let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. There's no abomination of desolation here. This is during the 40 days of the Son of Man, warning that they're about to be surrounded. After what? Well, they were already attacked right here. Right? This is the attack after the pre-trib. This is the Iran attack on Haifa and Tel Aviv. And the seven-day wedding and the meteor breaking up and hitting on the earth here. This is when he returns for his 40 days. He's here for 40 days, brings us, I think, to about 26th of Elul. They're going to wait in Jerusalem to be anointed by the Holy Ghost on Elul 29. And what's happening during these 3 days? Jerusalem is getting compassed about. And when this compassing about is done, Messiah has finished his 40 days as the prophet, as the Son of Man. When these 3 days are done, these guys are anointed by the Holy Ghost. It says they go out from Jerusalem in Luke 24. Only Luke in chapter 24 says they go from Jerusalem. And then what happens? The day and hour, no one knows, which is always the first or the second day, is called the day and hour, no one knows, for the Feast of Trumpets. This is the attack that killed Gedaliah. This is the attack by Ishmael. This is the attack by the raven, which means Arab. This is the attack, as scripture says, by Syria. This is the lion of the north, which is Assad. And this will be the attack. So what do you got? From Elul 29 to the end, like from the end of the year, from the 9th of Av till the last day of the year, Elul 29, which is to Feast of Trumpets, right? The moment before, is 50 days. This is the beginning of the Red Horse Rider. So that's what you're looking at in Luke. There's your Red Horse Rider, but he's telling you, but before all these, all of this other stuff is going to happen. And it represents the 40 days of the Son of Man when he said he would be as Jonah was. He's warning them, as he said he would do, as Jonah did. And they're to flee out when they see this compassing about. They flee out. Some of them stay. Some of them are killed. Some of them are captured. Some of them were obedient and they fled. And what happens? Jerusalem is destroyed. Now begins the 14 years. He then says in Luke 21, 22, "For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe to them that are with child and them that give suck in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled." You notice how different this discourse is compared to the others? Hello. You notice there's no day and hour, but clearly you can understand that there's a day you should be understanding to watch for. Now what happens when we go to Mark 13? We now know when Mark 13 starts, if Luke just told us in 21 that it says, "Then he said unto them, nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom." And then in verse 12, he says, "But before those things," and Luke's discourse is the "but before those things," then that means Luke, if Matthew, Mark, Luke of the synoptics in the end is Luke, Mark, Matthew, because the last will be first and the first will be last. What do you think Mark's discourse starts with? Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There it is right there. Mark 13:8. "For nation shall rise against kingdom, nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There shall be earthquakes in diverse places. There shall be famines, troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows." Do you see "but before all these"? Nope. This begins the 14 years of tribulation. It begins at the Red Horse Rider. Doesn't mean tribulation hasn't already started. Of course it has. But this is the beginning of the 14 years. And nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom is the Red Horse Rider when the sword is given. And the first place to be attacked by destruction is God's land itself, Jerusalem. Scripture just told us that if it's the Jews in the land and their year goes from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, when do you think this is going to happen? Feast of Trumpets? What does Jeremiah tell us with Nebuchadnezzar and then Ishmael at the Feast of Trumpets? The fifth and the ninth month, like Zechariah says, from chapter 1, these 7 years, and then those 7 years, fifth and seventh month. There were little pieces in all of these things over the years that didn't quite fit, that now the puzzle piece is there in its place. So what are we seeing? Nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom. Red Horse Rider is the beginning of war that begins, the official true beginning of World War III with the destruction of Jerusalem. This period of time lasts about 2.5 years until the abomination of desolation in Mark's gospel. And Mark's gospel is what? It's the church. Remember, this is the first 7 years of seals. So when you read this abomination of desolation, and it's different than the one in Matthew, it's because it represents like Moses' temple that was portable, covered in flesh, just like us, because the temple of God is still in the church. It's the sleeping church, the sleeping world that wasn't ready. And this is why the greatest revival in human history is going to happen during seals, especially the first half. Then you've got the abomination of desolation. And then what does it say? Okay, they're to flee. It's going to be worse than ever. There's your Antichrist and false prophet show up on the scene at the time of the mark of the beast, of course. And then when his time is over, which is he's getting 42 months to continue at that point, we now come to the end of Mark's discourse. And it says in Mark 13:24, but in those days after that tribulation, okay, shall the sun be darkened, powers in heaven shaken, then shall they see the Son of Man coming in clouds, plural. This is at the end of the sixth year of seals. This is why in Revelation, remember, we're talking about Feast of Trumpets in this a lot. This is why in Revelation chapter 6, at the end of it, they're saying, hide us in the rocks and in the mountains and fall on us. Hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come. Why? Because he's coming for the mid-trib, great multitude rapture group. He's coming on heavenly Mount Zion, which is paradise, the place that he prepared for them. And when is he coming? Well, let's see what it says. But of that day and hour knows no man. Do you guys not yet understand what that day and hour that no one knows means? The day and hour no one knows, just in case you aren't sure, is the Feast of Trumpets. The day and hour that no one knows is the Feast of Trumpets. So if it starts, as we've been explaining, that the 14 years after the pre-trib and the 50 days and the attack in Jerusalem begins at the Feast of Trumpets, and you go, let's go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, if we go to 6 years later, at the end of the first 6 years of seals, to the time of the Feast of Trumpets in 2030, look at what it says. There's the end of 6 years of seals. This is Elul 29, and this is the Feast of Trumpets 2030 to start the seventh year. So what would we get? Right here at Elul 29. And the Lord is seen coming. What did it just say? It just said of that day and hour, no one knows. The day and hour no one knows is the Feast of Trumpets. So he's going to come at the end of 6 years, and the seventh year starts, and he's coming on the day and hour no one knows. I didn't say it. Scripture tells you the day and hour no one knows in Mark's discourse. And when you understand the differences of the synoptic gospels and their groups and their timing, when you realize that the 50 days goes from the 9th of Av to the 1st of Tishri, which is the day and hour no one knows of the Feast of Trumpets, and then you go 6 more years, that would have the Lord coming on the day and hour no one knows, like he himself said. That would be the Feast of Trumpets 2030. when he comes at the Feast of Trumpets of 2030, what does he do? All we got to do is go to Scripture. They saw him coming, Feast of Trumpets, at the end of the sixth seal. What does he do? He's going to seal the 144,000 first. They're going to help the workers that were there working during seals. And they're going to help bring in the great multitude rapture at about Passover time, because their harvest is at this time. But their portion is connected to Passover, or second Passover potentially, which is right here. So first or second Passover, most likely second Passover, because Christ fulfilled the first one, is going to be connected to here. So even though the great multitude rapture, that harvest is done at the end of 6 years, and that's where the spring wheat is ready and is harvested in late summer to early fall, it won't be observed and it'll be brought in at the time of Passover. Hence, you see the 144,000 being sealed before the great multitude rapture coming in. And then you go to chapter 8 of Revelation, and you see the seventh seal, and it says about half an hour. I believe that's about 6 months is the typology, which would make it between, 5 or 6 months. I believe it'll be about 5 months, because it's 7 months to second Passover, where that group would then be observed of the great multitude rapture coming in. So we're following the storyline here. All right. Where is it? We're following the storyline. There's the rapture. Then in the second half of the seventh year of seals, right, there's that silence in heaven. I believe this is where the Lord makes his covenant with all nations, right? He's making the covenant with the nations. And then what happens? In September, at the Feast of Trumpets, the day and hour no one knows, the beginning of what starts? Of 2031. In 2031, look at this. Feast of Trumpets 2031 to Feast of Trumpets 2032 is the first year of the trumpet judgments. Now, how could that be? Well, I just showed you it starts the 14 years at trumpets. I just showed you that the end of 6 years and the start of the seventh year is them seeing the Lord coming on the day and hour no one knows at the Feast of Trumpets. We now then understand that if it's 1 year later, the final 7 years of tribulation, or the first year of trumpet judgments, is now beginning 1 year later from when he came at the Feast of Trumpets. And how can we prove that out? All we got to do is now go to Matthew's discourse. And in Matthew's discourse, we see, of course, I'm not going to go into everything we've covered before. Here they are only in Matthew asking about the coming of the end of the world. There's a reason why it's only in Matthew's discourse, because they're talking about his return, his coming feet down on the Mount of Olives, when he's going to be seen as lightning coming from one end to the other. We see their tribulation, the things that are going against the nation against them. We've talked about why the false prophet is in the first half and not the false Christ. We've covered all of these things. This is the abomination of desolation. Why is this one in the holy place? Because in the first half of trumpets, for all of you guys that don't know, in the first 3.5 years of trumpets, the city, street, and temple is being rebuilt. Now, when Messiah gets cut off at mid-trumpets, which is a total of what? 10.5 years, okay? 10.5 years total since tribulation began. We know that the pit is open, Antichrist comes back, Satan has been cast down, and now they're going to stand in the holy place of the temple itself. Satan's going to have how long? Well, we know from Revelation chapter 12, we just recently covered this as well. In Revelation chapter 12, when Satan is cast down, we know that he has but a short time. We know 100% what this short time is. In Daniel chapter 12, while those guys flee from Revelation 12 for the final 3.5 years, we know of those final 3.5 years, Satan has time times and a half. No and, because it's not an addition. It's 1, 2, and a half. 1, 2 plus a half. That's 2.5. So we know Satan's time is he's going to have 2.5 years of the final 3.5 years, which leaves us, or brings us to, the end of 13 years total tribulation, which is the end of 6 years of trumpet judgments. Which means if it is 6 years, if it started at Feast of Trumpets, if the end of six and the seventh year of seals started at the Feast of Trumpets, then that means the end of 13 years should end on the last day of the year, and this should begin the seventh year at the Feast of Trumpets 2037. Well, is that what Scripture says? Let's have a look. Let's go to Matthew chapter 24. And what do we read in Matthew 24? Not quite the same as we read in Mark's, but very similar. Mark 24, 36. But of that day and hour. But of that day and hour knows no man. Well, how about that? Which means when the sixth year of trumpet judgments are done and the 13th year of tribulation total, that means day one should be the day and hour that no one knows in what? 2037. From 31 to 37, that means when Jesus is going to return, excuse me, feet down on the Mount of Olives to start the 14th year, the final year of tribulation, the seventh year of trumpet judgments. He's coming on the day and hour no one knows. But what else does it say that gives us even more understanding? Of course, this word coming is only used in all the Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels. It's only used in Matthew, and it's only used 4 times, and all 4 is in Matthew 24 about the coming of the Lord when he returns feet down. Remember, at this point, this is when he's coming as lightning from one end into the other. Did you see Luke's discourse talk about as it was in the days of Noah? Nope. Did Mark's discourse, when it talked about the day and hour no one knows, did it go on to talk about as it was in the days of Noah? Nope. Only Matthew's. Only Matthew's, as we've taught before, says that when he comes on the day and hour that no one knows, it'll be as it was in the days of Noah, when he comes as lightning from one end to the other. Right? So here he is, Feast of Trumpets 2037, on the day and hour no one knows, returning feet down on the Mount of Olives. Right? Pretty straightforward. We can see it. Well, when we went to Genesis chapter 7, let's go see what it means as it was in the days of Noah. The days of Noah, of when the flood started, it said in verse 11, in the 600th year, in the second month, don't worry about what month. We're looking at the count, okay? It's prophetic typologies. It started on the second month, and the 17th day of the month. What started? The waters broke up, and it was what? The 40 days, right? The 40 days began. Second month, 17th day. The 40 days began. What happens when we go to Luke chapter 4? As we've discussed, remember 1, 2, 3, 4? If you understand Luke in order, for anybody that's new watching this, Luke in order is an absolute incredible prophetic revelation. And if you want to understand it, first watch those intro videos, but then come and watch this one right here. The mystery of Luke knowing all things in order. Okay? This one right here. if you comprehend what's being revealed in all these revelations, you watch that intro, that one's gonna blow your mind, okay? Because watch what happens. We come now into Luke chapter 4, and we know Luke chapter 4 is a prophetic picture. Luke chapter 1 is the pre-trib and the 7-day wedding to the 8th day. The 8th day is the birth of Christ, but we know that fulfillment is 2 months later, from Isaiah 9 to Matthew 4. We know that Luke chapter 3 is a prophetic picture of him coming at the end of 6 years of seals. And we know Luke chapter 4 is a prophetic picture built in it of the Lord returning after 13 years of tribulation, or after the sixth year of trumpets, when he's coming, just as we showed here at the Feast of Trumpets, feet down on the day and hour no one knows, just like Matthew 24 said, and who had been given authority over the earth for the final what? 2.5 years. Who was given that authority? Satan was. Satan was cast down. The pit was open. Antichrist, who we now know is going to be the indwelt of Lucifer and the false prophet, are there. But we know he was given only 2.5 years. He knew his time was short. Here comes the Lord returning, feet down on the Mount of Olives. So when he comes, who do you think is here who has all the control? Satan. So how fitting that the prophetic typology of Luke 4 is when the Lord returns, feet down on the Mount of Olives, and we're told that it would be as it was in the days of Noah, right? And the days of Noah start off with what? 40 days. That's right. They start off with 40 days, right? And look who's tempting Christ for 40 days. The devil. The devil, who is called Satan, who is the serpent, is the one who in the is of the events that took place. Sorry, I'm just putting my jacket back on. Of the events that took place, Satan is the one who is here now tempting him for 40 days, which is a prophetic picture of the 40 days of Noah and the final year beginning of the trumpet judgments and of the 14th year of tribulation. Starting with 40 days. How did it start with the days of Noah? It started with 40 days. It started with 40 days. Do you think we're just twisting stuff? Do you think this stuff is being made up when all of it falls into place? When all of it is in order? It's incredible. So what happens when we go to Genesis chapter 8? Well, you guys know this. Remember, we're looking at it in the final year of tribulation that it said it would be as it was in the days of Noah. We count out from when the days began. And what does it say in Genesis 8:14? That it was all done in the second month, 27th day. 1 year and 10 days long. Now, those of you who have been following for a bit, I know you know what that means. Excuse me. And we're going to cover it again. We'll touch on it again because I'm going to make the final obvious pointed statement about proving that it has to be the Feast of Trumpets that it all starts at and ends at. So look at these Jewish wedding customs. This is a great one. We've shared on some of this before, and I'm going to go into that video clip here now in a moment. But there's three portions. There's the they call it different things here, but you have the first one, which is the commitment, the agreement that's made that when they become of age, this is going to be the agreement that we covenant to. And then you're going to have this engagement where there's an official wedding. But then after you have the wedding and you go under the huppah, then what happens? You're officially married, but for 1 year, they don't get to live together because the husband has to go and prepare a place for his bride. Okay, let's read this real quick and then we're going to go into the video clips. It says here, let's start in up here. During the Urisin period, the groom was to prepare a place for his bride while the bride focused on her personal preparations, wedding garments, lamps, etc. Although the bride knew to expect her groom after about a year, she did not know the exact day or hour. He could come earlier. No, he's not. It was the father of the groom who gave the final approval for him to return to collect his bride. Listen to this. For that reason, the bride kept her oil lamps ready. Sound familiar? Kept her oil lamps ready at all times in that final year, right? Just in case the groom came at night, sounding the shofar. So, about 1 year, a day and hour she doesn't know, with a blast of the shofar, and it would only be 1 or 2 days to lead the bridal procession to the home he had prepared for her, like the parable of the 10 virgins, of course, in Matthew 25. But the whole world thinks because they read from Matthew and they don't understand Luke and Mark, they think it's a pre-trib picture of the bride of Christ. It's the post-trib. I've already shown you that the pre-trib bride of Christ, the Gentile bride, is the last 50 is the first 50 days in the above, at the beginning of those 50 days before the 14 years even begins. Here comes the Lord returning, feet down on the Mount of Olives, as it was in the days of Noah, for 1 year and 10 days from the Feast of Trumpets. And how long has it been? 13 years, right? It will have been 13 years total of tribulation, which, do we have evidence that when 13 years are accomplished, that a wedding can take place, and then that he goes away for 1 year, and when he returns at that 1 year, a wedding takes place after that? Is there evidence of that? Well, what I just showed you was part of the answer, where it said he left for 1 year. After the wedding, there's 1 year where he's going to prepare a place for it. If you haven't understood yet, this 1 year is the earth being prepared after he destroys all of the enemies. And then the earth is replenished and renewed for the millennial reign. That starts the Jubilee. Listen to this. For those of you who haven't heard this before, get ready. And I'm not, please understand, I am not making fun of this pastor. He has incredible insight, incredible understanding. This is Jay McCarl. He's an incredible pastor. I love a lot of his stuff. But for everything that he understands in relation to this, he has no idea of what the scripture is talking about prophetically in its timing. And he's no different than the rest of the world of church that thinks that Matthew 25 with the foolish and wise virgins is the pre-trib bride of Christ. It couldn't be more absolutely polar opposite. Because what he's saying is pre-trib is at the end of this year, the 14th year, when the pre-trib begins it all. This is the Gentile bride. This is the Jewish bride at the start of it, and then at the year and 10 days later. Year and 10 days later? Hold on. You'll see what I'm saying. Have a listen to this. So this is about the Galilean or the Jewish wedding process, for which he thinks is a picture of the end of the world. Now, it is, but on the complete opposite spectrum that he thinks he understands. Again, I'm not making fun. I'm making a point to show you how crystal clear it is when you understand the importance of the revelation of the differences of who the Gospels are speaking to. It is the core revelation of it all, and it all proves what? That the 14 years begin and end at the Feast of Trumpets. Not maybe, not kind of, not sort of. I am going to unequivocally prove it out as I bring it to an end as we go through this, that it is unequivocally from Scripture, from traditions, from history, from historical records, going to be the Feast of Trumpets. Proving that if it goes from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, the 50 days that come first and everything we have absolutely, unequivocally, 100% proven of it, shows us that whatever we're looking for between now and then isn't going to be the pre-trib, but maybe events to be highly aware of that we can start proclaiming more to people. Listen to this.
That you have a family.
Oh, let me slow this down. That's just too slow. I'm sorry, guys. So you'll see me. I'm only on a quarter extra speed, okay?
And another family. And, well, you know, they've all survived well. The papas lived to a ripe old age and all of that. One of the papas of these two families who might be...
Most people have no clue that in 2023,
oh, come on now.
The best way to make money on Amazon is not...
thing or something else, but let me just give you a hypothetical, okay? And I'm going to build on this hypothetical because, again, it could be just about anything.
I love this.
But let's assume that you have a family and another family, and, well, you know, they've all survived well. The papas lived to a ripe old age and all of that. One of the papas of these two families, who might be a merchant in a village, just some particular Galilean village, he's got a son. Son is about 4 or 5 years old. And the merchant is going through the village, and he's going about his business. And as he's standing in one place talking to another villager, he hears children playing. And he looks at the children, and they're playing, and he notices a little girl. The little girl's about 3 years old. But she seems to be a very happy little girl. She looks very healthy. She appears to be very obedient to her parents. I think she'd make a great bride for my son. Now, you're probably horrified, but that's the way they do things over there. Still to this day, among the Arabs over there, especially the very medieval-thinking Arabs and some of the more, what you might say, primitive areas that are over in the Middle East. It looks like I'm talking down, but no, there are areas that just, they live like medieval times over there. And this is what they still do, but they did this back then, too. And you would have this Jewish father, he looks and says, she'd make a great bride for my 4-year-old son. And so he gets it in his mind, we have to get them engaged. So he puts a feast together. Now, feasts would last several days, and even if he's really poor, he's going to do his very best to impress. And when he gets the feast together, then he sends one of his family members over to the house where the papa of the little girl lives. They pound on the door. Remember yesterday? I have a gospel for you. This is good news. Pounds on the door. They come to the door and said, maybe it's the guy's oldest son or something. He says, my father would like you to come over and have a feast. What are you going to do? You literally drop everything and go. They didn't live by the clock back then, remember? You could just do that. That's the way. Any of you who have done missions in third world countries, you know this is true. That's what people do. So he drops everything. He goes over to the other papa's house, escorted by the oldest son. And he goes into the house, and here's this feast set up. And the papa greets him warmly, gives him a holy kiss, shaloms him, gives him the gesture. And then they sit down at the feast. They recline at the table, and they begin eating, and they do lots and lots of small talk. And after a few hours, or maybe a day or two... yeah, they'd even sleep right there at the table because these feasts would just go on like that. You say, what about his responsibilities at home? They didn't have clocks. Didn't matter. They knew he'd be back. They know where he was. He's over there. You know, it's okay. So as they're feasting, the papa of the little boy wines and dines the papa of the little girl until finally he pops the question, how about your daughter becoming engaged to my son? And if the other papa agrees, then immediately they find a scribe, maybe somebody in the household that can read or write. And remember, not everybody did back then. In fact, reading and writing was the exception, not the rule. And so they have to find a scribe. And the scribe now is going to write down a contract in duplicate. It's got to be letter for letter, a duplicate contract. And these guys now go into negotiations for that little girl. Because the papa of the bride has to buy her. The papa of the groom, rather, has to buy the girl. And there are other stipulations. So the scribe comes. And they begin to write things down. Now, this is just letter. But what are they going to write this on? Have you ever thought about that? You see, we're so used to the way we do things today. You know, we say, well, people, we need to read our Bibles. We have the Bible. That's great. Do you know that we only had Bibles to read for about 400 years? That's why Paul said faith comes by and hearing by the Word of God. Because if you wanted to learn the Word of God, you had to go listen to it being read to you. So people that could read and write were rare back then. And you go and find a scribe, it could be a family member, and they're going to write on anything they can write on. They're not going to go down to Staples and buy a ream of paper and get some pencils. They're going to etch something into leather. They're going to write it on broken pottery shards. They might scratch it into wood. They might even write it on a stone. But it's going to be a perfect duplicate, and this is going to be a legal and binding contract for those people. They call it a ketubah. The Yiddish version is ketubah, but it's a ketubah is what it is. And it's a contract, but it's a covenant. And so the first thing they discuss is, what is the price of the bride? And eventually they negotiate back and forth as if they're negotiating for merchandise, and it comes out to be, oh, so many camels and some donkeys and a flock of sheep, whatever they can come up with, usually product rather than money. And when that's done, they write that down. They have it written down in duplicate on this contract, this ketubah. And then they talk about the bride's dowry, which is usually, once again, animals, because that was where their value was. That was where their wealth was found, of course, in their animals. It could be money if they were rich families and they would, you know, agree on coinage or what have you. Because if anything happened to the bridegroom, there was nothing to support the bride. Forgive the way I state this, but after she's married, she is considered damaged goods. She's not likely to get married again. It's possible, but not likely. And the families don't support well, especially if the family starts dying off. She's out on her own. She's got to find a way to survive. So this is kind of either, if he leaves her, then it's her alimony. If he dies or becomes incapacitated, then this is her welfare, as it were. So they work on the dowry. They want to make sure she's well covered, and they negotiate this. They negotiate something else. They negotiate how many children they're going to have and of what gender. You say, how do they do that? I don't know. But they would put this in there. Have you ever noticed in the Bible, but not just in the Bible, but in Middle Eastern culture, ancient and new, that it's shameful for women not to have children? You ever wondered why? Well, it's important to have children. It's honorable. That's very true. But in a ketubah, if you didn't have children, it could be a breach of contract. Now, what about love? Where does love come into it? Folks, love does not put food on the table. These arranged marriages increase the size of a family, the capacity of a family to do business, the wealth of a family, and the social power that they had within the village. Suddenly you combine the families, and they are powerful. So they would also get these arranged marriages going just to be able to expand the power base or the wealth of the family or the influence of the family. Love was not a consideration. You say, man, that's terrible. That's life. That's what they did. And so they would write all of these things down. And finally, they would have them read back to them. They would be proofread, these two duplicate ketubahs, these contracts, and make sure they were just right. And when they were fully agreed upon, then the papas would graciously part company. One of them, the papa leaving with the little girl, would go with his ketubah in hand. The other papa, they would do the same thing. They would put it in what we would call their most sacred shrine. Now, that doesn't mean a place where there are idols. It means the place where you keep the ceremonial hardware of the family, special cups and special plates for special occasions, sort of the family safe. And it goes in there, and it sits there until the day the children come of age to get betrothed, which is different than the engagement. At the ripe old age of 13 or 14 years old.
Hello. Did you hear that? 13 to 14 years old. It's actually 13. We've shown in the past, too, that Mary was actually believed to be 13, and she had Jesus when she was in her 14th year. It was 13 years old, brothers and sisters. Why does J. Carl miss this? Because nobody understands that the end of days is 14 years, and it's the prophetic picture of the wedding that builds to the time of Matthew. It's 13 years old. So there's this contract covenant made. Here it is right here. And when the 13 years are over, when she's 13 years old in the prophetic typology, then what happens? The marriage. The marriage. The hoopah marriage that we were talking about. This is what he's going to share on next. There's this hoopah marriage that's going to take place. So let's keep listening to the next part. That's just such a very important piece to understand in relation to Why is it 13 years? And why is there one more year of the 14th? Well, now that you understand that the women would get married at 13 years old with an agreement that was made sometime earlier, but once she was 13, then it was fulfilled, and now they could be married, and then he's got to prepare a place for 1 year, and then when he comes back after that 1 year, what happens? The wedding celebration. They're already married, but then there's this big celebration that takes place. But that doesn't happen till under after that year. At the end of 13 years, the official marriage has taken place. But now he's going to be preparing what? The earth. Now the earth is going to be getting prepared. So listen to what he says next.
13 years old. And when the papas decide, look, it's time to get these people, these kids betrothed, they would start to prepare a ceremony, because a betrothal, now this sounds like a contradiction, but a betrothal was a legal and binding wedding.
There you go. You see? So what does that mean? The betrothal, after the end of 13 years, that's where the wedding takes place. So there's an official wedding. It's become legal and binding that they would be married. And this is what I was showing you guys over here in the huppah. So what happens is they have their huppah wedding ceremony, see? And when that was over and he had to go and prepare a place, he would go for 1 year. And when he goes for 1 year, he's preparing the place for her. Do you think it's a coincidence that it's 13 years and then one more year for 14? Of course it's not. Let's keep going. Watch what this all leads up to. Where are we going here? 43:20.
She puts the veil on. The betrothal is over. Everybody shouts!
Yeah.
No.
Okay, see? So now she's put the veil on. The betrothal is over. Okay? So now the veil goes on. And that wedding at the end of 13th year under the huppah, it's over. So now the wedding's over. The veil is on. It shows that she's taken, she's spoken for, and her man's gone to prepare a place for her for 1 year. Okay?
No. They shout!
Yeah.
Very good. Because that's the end of it. Now, she finishes up. She's got the veil. They pack up the huppah. All the ceremony is over. The people go back to whatever they were doing. The witnesses are now very happy. They saw a happy time. It broke up their day. And the families go back in a parade to their separate houses. The boy with his family, the girl with her family. And there, now they begin to make preparations for the wedding, which will take place a year later. As they do so, she goes home and she begins to put together her bridal gown. Now, that's a big project, especially if you're a poor peasant.
So like he said, it kind of sounds like a contradiction. So there, it's an agreement, right, where they were officially married. You know, it really isn't a marriage, but it's not the final marriage, okay? So I made it sound like the other one was the marriage and then it's just a celebration. It's still, it's like a pre-marriage and then the 1 year, and then, you know, he's making it more clear that it's the big marriage when everything will be prepared and ready, okay? But it's still that 13th year. And then 1 year. So listen what happens now during this 1 year.
Present, but you're going to be actually bartering and bargaining for every piece of cloth you can find. An ancient bridal gown for the bride was just an explosion of colors and whatever type of cloth that she could get her hands on. Ladies, you would be bargaining with every caravan that came by to see what they had just so you could get scraps of cloth and then sew this thing together. It wouldn't look patchwork. They would be very careful about it. She would try and get all the jewelry she could. She would have to borrow it. If it was poor, again, a poor neighborhood, then it might be tin jewelry. It might be maybe brass or bronze. If it was a wealthy family, of course, a lot better than that. But the more jewelry she had on, the better. Everyone liked it. Don't fall into a lake. You're going straight to the bottom. She would have necklace after necklace after necklace. And of course, even in the ancient Middle East, when you go to museums, you realize the baubles on these necklaces were sometimes as big as your fist. And she'd have these things all around her neck. She'd have bottles of perfume hanging from her neck. And then, of course, around her veil, she would take coins from a dowry, if she had it in coins, and she would put these around her veil, and just to show off her dowry, which was like her wedding ring, she would have bracelets going all the way up her arm if she could. I mean, she would jingle and jangle when she moved. This is the way an ancient bride looked, and it would take about a year to get all this together. And she'd have her bridesmaids with her, which might have been her girlfriends or her sisters, and they would always keep oil lamps with them to make sure that if the bridegroom came at night, they would light the lamps. You know, Matthew 25 in the parable of the ten.
There you go. Do you see what's going on? Do you see how fantastic it is that the final year, and we're not done yet, but in that final year that the Lord has returned, feet down on the Mount of Olives after 13 years, on the day and hour that no one knows, and while he's here for that 1 year and 10 days, as you're going to see, that it's represented as the days of Noah. And when that time is over and you go into Matthew 25, you see what happens as you follow the storyline? It's now the kingdom of heaven, because it's going to be the time of what? The millennial reign. The 14 years will be over. It'll be the Jubilee. It's likened unto the kingdom of heaven, because now the kingdom of heaven is starting. And what do we get the parable of? You got it. The parable of the 10 virgins. Do you think this is pre-trib still? This is the year and 10 days after, or the year, and then you're going to see why the 10 days after. This is the actual wedding at the end of that year when the bridegroom is now coming. This is the end of the 14th year of tribulation. Let's keep going.
And virgins, that's where that comes in. So they would keep the lamps charged with oil on hand to make sure that when the bridegroom comes. In the meantime, the bridegroom goes home and he does two things. He's got a year to put together a feast for however many guests they're going to have that's going to have to last several days. This is a big project, once again, especially if you're poor. So he begins trading and working for the dried food that will keep for a long time. As the day gets closer, he gets to the food that doesn't need as much preservation, and the very close to the day, the fresh food that he's got to get. And he's got to get oil and wine and everything else and store it away and get it ready for this great day, and he has a year to do it. But then during that time, he's got another big project. He's got to add a room onto his father's house, his compound.
There you go, see? So he's preparing a place, right? Adding a place to his father's house. Now let's go to a little bit further. Watch this.
So the bridegroom gets done. It's a year later. The wedding ceremony is going to take place. He calls his father and he says, "Dad, I'm done." And he has to go through the formalities of having the father inspect the meal. He has to inspect the bridal chamber and the room where they're going to live. And when it's done, his father says, "Well done, son. We're ready to go." And the son says, "Great. I want to get my bride." He's got his brothers and his friends living with him. The bride has got her sisters and her girlfriends staying with her. They're getting ready to put the wedding together. This is how it's going to be. Everybody's posed for the picture, so to speak. And the father says, "Right, son, I'll tell you when." What? Yeah. This is the one thing that made a Galilean wedding a Galilean wedding. Because unlike every other wedding in the region, you always planned on when the bridegroom came to get the bride. The Galileans, being the rebels that they were, added one ingredient to their ceremony. It was a surprise wedding. You ladies are horrified hearing that, I'm sure. The guys are going, "I wouldn't want that." But that's the way they played the game. They knew about when it was going to take place because people would talk about it. There would be certain signs that would indicate that the bridegroom will be coming to get the bride soon, and they would drop hints all over the place, but nobody knew when it was going to happen, except one man, the Father. No one knows the day or the hour of the coming of the Son of Man, not the angels of heaven, not even the Son, only the Father knows.
You see, what he's now proclaiming is, of course, Matthew chapter 24. He's going into Matthew 24, and he's now trying to say, see, this is the day and hour no one knows. Yet, what he's talking about is the year later, when it comes to an end, at the day and hour no one knows, which is showing you what? The day and hour no one knows. Not only did it start with the first attack on the day and hour no one knows, not only did the sixth year of seals come to an end and it start the seventh year on the day and hour no one knows, not only did the end of the sixth year come at the day and hour no one knows, like Matthew said, to start the seventh year, at the day and hour no one knows, but when this 1 year of him being gone to prepare a place, when he comes back and the Father gives him the go-ahead, you guessed it, it's the day and hour that no one knows. Craziness, right? Trying to say, "Oh, you can't tell." And he goes on a little bit of a rant there, saying, "So quit trying to guess." He doesn't even realize what he's saying in saying nobody knows the day and hour. He doesn't understand the timing of when he's saying no one knows the day or hour. And then at the end of it, he says, because of this wedding in the parable of the 10 virgins, in Matthew 25, that's why he believes in the pre-tribulation rapture. But he's telling everybody, don't guess the day and hour. No one knows it. And then he says that's why he believes because of Matthew 25. You see how twisted it is? But am I angry? Am I trying to poke fun? No. I'm trying to let you guys know and to see how incredibly valuable, how incredibly blessed we have been for some reason to be chosen to understand all of these things. When we shared this in the past, it was the same type of thing that I taught on with it. But now we have every part and puzzle piece that goes in its place. Proven the 50 days before. Proven how it can be with the Feast of Weeks. How we get the true new wine. How it all starts the 14 years after the 50 on the Feast of Trumpets. And then Feast of Trumpets. And then Feast of Trumpets. And then Feast of Trumpets. And one more year, Feast of Trumpets. Because it's all in order, guys.
White linen robes. Oh, one more thing has happened during this time. I almost forgot to tell you. The father of the bridegroom, if it's a wealthier family, not a poor family, they couldn't afford to do this. The father of the bridegroom also prepares a gift for all the invited guests, white linen robes. When they come into the compound for the wedding, he passes out these white linen robes and everybody puts them on. These are their wedding garments. Everybody.
Well, how about that? Everybody at the Jewish wedding, when they all go in, they get their beautiful white robes. Well, did you see that mentioned? Anything about that in Luke's wedding story? Nope. Nothing about Luke's wedding story, right? From what we talked about earlier. Do you know when you go to Matthew's wedding story, chapter 20 or 22? 22. In Matthew's wedding story, guess what we get? You betcha you got it, right? Everybody gets what? A white wedding garment. Not in Luke's, but in Matthew's, and Mark's has no wedding story. When people understand the revelation of the Gospels and what their prophetic differences are telling us, it answers everything. It opens up all of it. It doesn't mean we know absolutely everything. Instead, we got to be diligent and seek it out. And more and more and more and more continues to be revealed. Everything he's talking about is the post-trib return of the Lord, feet down, preparing the earth, then receiving his bride, and the wedding on the day and hour no one knows. When that final wedding at the 14th year is over, the guests all get these garments. That's why it's not in Luke. It's the post-trib Jewish bride. So awesome.
Has to wear one. And you see this in the parable of the great banquet, where a king is preparing a banquet. It happens to be a wedding feast. And then the invited guests, who are wealthy people, make horrible, insulting excuses why they can't be there. Send my servants out into the highways and byways. Bring these guys in. Bring in the Gentiles. Bring them in. And when they do, everybody comes in. And where do you find them? They're wearing white linen robes. It's a rich man's house. And the gate is shut, but they do find one man in the midst who's not wearing a white linen robe. And he says, how'd that guy get in here? Why did they make the robes? It honors the guests. The guests get to take them home as gifts. But it also prevents gate crashers. You get a lot of people gathered together, and it's a society of limited means. And there are very, very hungry people there, and if they can just get in, they can partake of the feast. But if everybody's dressed in white robes, gate crashers don't have them. And you can spot them. Right now, throw that guy out where the wailing and gnashing of teeth is. And so that's that parable. So, the father of the bridegroom.
Did you hear that? How could you say that it's a pre-trib wedding when there's guests that don't have the robes on that are thrown out into the weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth? When the weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth is when everything's over. It's at post-trib. Just a simple observed contradiction right there, right?
He's got the robes ready. The bridegroom, he's sleeping with the guys in the room. They're all packed into one little room. The girls all packed into one little room. She's got her wedding dress on. They got their white robes on. She doesn't have her veil on. They're going to put that on before she steps outside, and they have one lamp burning. And this goes on for maybe a day or two. It doesn't last too long. They just don't know when it.
Did you hear that?
It's going to happen.
Did you hear that? Remember what this said? It's the exact same thing. She knew that it was about 1 year, but she didn't know the exact day and hour that it would happen. And then Jay McCarroll is telling us, when the father says, okay, well done, son. Now you got to wait for me when I say it's time. He then tells us that not only is it a day and hour she doesn't know, which means Feast of Trumpets, he just finished telling us that the time that has to be waited for is no more than 1 or 2 days. What is the definition of the day and hour? No one knows. What is the definition of the day and hour? No one knows. Feast of Trumpets? Feast of Trumpets? The day and hour no one knows is because it's either 1 day or the first day or the second day. The day and hour no one knows, but she knows it's about a year. And we know it started at the Feast of Trumpets. And we know that it goes a year and 10 days in this count. And we know that it's in this year, being from trumpets to trumpets, that it's only 1 or 2 days. Because it's the day and hour no one knows. And so when we understand this 13 years for 13 years old, and then the ceremony and under the huppah, and then the 1 year later, day and hour no one knows. Are you getting it? Everything is showing us that the 14 years begins and ends at the Feast of Trumpets. And we're going to finish the story here.
And in the middle of the night, typically, with the father holding an oil lamp, he comes into the room and he steps over all those guys and he comes over to his son and he grabs his son. Son! What? Wake up. Why? Son? What, Dad? Go get your bride. Boing! He leaps to his feet. He starts making all the noise he can. He reaches for a ram's horn trumpet, a shofar, and he lets go a blast on that thing as loud as he can make it. This is the alarm.
Hello. So wait a second. It's 1 year later, on a day and hour no one knows. It's only a day or two before the father tells him he can go do it, which is the day and hour no one knows of the Feast of Trumpets. And at the Feast of Trumpets, what do they blow? You guessed it, the shofar.
Alarm clock for the whole village. Everybody wakes up because he's got to wake up the guests. They don't.
It's so exciting, man. Here, just a couple more clips from this.
Dancing around the bridegroom and singing songs and making a big fuss, and he just absorbs it and takes it in. This is his moment. He gets to go get his bride, and they start shouting, the bridegroom is coming, the bridegroom is coming. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And then
now, why is that exciting? Because when you go to Matthew chapter 25, which is at the end of the year of Noah, remember? So you've got that 1 year, and then you've got 10 days. What are they saying? Right? The bridegroom is coming. Some of them don't have their lamps, right? They're going to be left out. Some five do, five don't. Right? And then what happens? They missed it and the door was shut. They missed it and the door was shut. The whole story, guys, is the end of tribulation.
And singing as it winds through the streets. It's an amazing thing. In the meantime, this has woken up the bride. All this fuss, and she's got just a few minutes to get herself in order. She stands up, all the bridesmaids dust all the stuff off of her because they've been sleeping on the floor or something like that. You know, so they got to get her all clean. They fix her makeup. She's heavily made up, even under her veil. So her eyes are all painted. Remember, they came out of Egypt. They knew these things. Her hands are painted with.
Okay, you see that? So now, remember, she had her veil on. So anytime during that year, if she went out in public, she would be wearing her veil. Of course, inside, she didn't have to have it on. But now that 1 year has come to an end. On the day and hour, no one knows, and he's coming. So she puts the veil on. They're dusting themselves all off, and they're getting all ready, right? So as we follow the story, what do we know this brings us to? If it's brought us through the final year, as it was from the day of Noah, which is the final year from Matthew 24 to then the start of Matthew 25, and the days of Noah are what? 1 year. And 10 days. So it goes from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets. How can we prove that even this is the Feast of Trumpets in addition to everything that I've already showed you, that it's Feast of Trumpets. How can we bring it together and prove that it's Feast of Trumpets? Well, does that mean the wedding's going to happen right on the Feast of Trumpets? No. Because that final year was what? 1 year and 10 days long. The days of Noah were 1 year and 10 days. Do you remember that? 1 year and 10 days long in the story of Noah. And if you recall, from Leviticus chapter 25, this is the nail in the coffin. What does it say about the Jubilee year? It says, and thou shalt number seven Sabbaths of years. Okay? How many times have we showed you guys? These are the seven Sabbaths. The first one began with the Jubilee year, 1989's Feast of Trumpets to 1990. That was year one. Seven Sabbaths. The seventh one ends, and this count goes all the way back to Christ in Luke chapter 4. Just as we've shown in the previous videos. Which means when this final year is over, which is Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, then 10 days later is the blasting of the shofar. Do you understand what that means? Only, as I've said before, only the 49th year. This is the 49th year of the seven times seven Sabbaths. Only the 49th final year is 1 year and 10 days long. Only in Matthew's, after the return of the Lord, feet down, is it as it was in the days of Noah, which was 1 year and 10 days long. Why is it an additional 10 days? Why is it only in Matthew? And why is Matthew's trumpet judgments? And why is Matthew's the one to Noah? And Noah's is 1 year and 10 days long. How does all of this even prove? In addition to everything showing Feast of Trumpets? Well, listen to what it says. Okay? When the seven times 7 years are done, that means the 49 years. Do you know what that means? Do you realize what this is already saying? It has to go from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets. Do you get it? Listen to what it says. Then shalt thou cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound. Listen to this. You want to nail it down? If anybody tries to tell you you don't know what you're talking about, that you can't prove that it's Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, even though with everything I've just told you, when they understand that the final seventh year of the tribulation, even, listen to this, even if somebody doesn't want to believe the truth of the 14 years, and they only believe in seven, they need to understand that that final seventh year must be the 49th year of a Jubilee cycle. It must be. It's right here. Why? Why must it be? Because when the tribulation is over, the Jews are going to be brought in back into their land, and they're going to be what? Proclaiming liberty, and they're all going to be getting their portions of land back. So clearly, the end of the final seventh year of tribulation, for those that believe in seven, that final year has to be a year and 10 days long. And that means that 10-day portion is in the first year of the next set of 49, which makes it the Jubilee year. But how does it prove that means the 7 years of tribulation that they think, but really the 14 years? How does that prove that it goes from trumpets to trumpets? From Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets? Then shall thou cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month, on the Day of Atonement. Hello? If the final year is 1 year and 10 days long, and that means the 49th year of a 7 times 7 year cycle, only the 49th is 1 year and 10 days long, and those additional 10 days after those 10 days is when you sound the shofar for the Jubilee, And it tells you that that day is the Day of Atonement? What's 10 days earlier? If this is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, what's 10 days earlier? Feast of Trumpets. That means the year is going from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, guys. Because that final 14th year, this proves, if you take it in reverse, it proves that the final year had to go from Feast of Trumpets to Feast of Trumpets, because there's no other way to add 10 days to a year and get to Day of Atonement for the blast of the shofar at the final Jubilee. Which means if you take it back to the end of the 13th year, when the Lord is coming feet down on the Mount of Olives, it means it had to have been the Feast of Trumpets, which is why it says in Matthew, the day and hour no one knows. And if that equals that to the end of 13 years, and Mark also tells you it's to the day and hour no one knows, and we know it's to the end of the sixth year of seals when he's coming on heavenly Mount Zion, then it must be the Feast of Trumpets, the day and hour no one knows. And so if you take it back 6 years before to the beginning of the entirety of tribulation, of when the 14 years start, which is the attack on Jerusalem, which was historically proven of what was, shall be, and it was the Feast of Trumpets. Are you getting it? Do you understand how crystal clear it is? This is why I'm speaking to you so boldly. Do you think for a moment, after 6.5 years of all of these incredible revelations, pieces and parts and puzzle getting more and more and more and more clear, do you think I would ever speak so boldly as this, as telling you 100% unequivocally, with absolute certainty, the 14 years at the Red Horse Rider begins at the Feast of Trumpets? The end of first 6 years is the Feast of Trumpets. The beginning of the 7 years of trumpets is Feast of Trumpets. That the end of 13 is Feast of Trumpets. That the end of 14 is Feast of Trumpets. And then 10 days to the shofar blast of the Jubilee. I'm telling you, it is 100% unequivocal that it is absolute truth. You ever hear me talk like that before? Only with the 50 days and only in these recent last couple few months, because the final pieces of the puzzle are in place that have proven the timing and the understanding of the 50 days and the beginning of the 14 years. The final pieces are in place for those things, not everything, not absolutely everything, but for those things. They are all set in their place, perfectly fit, finish that portion of the puzzle with absolute certainty. This is why I'm saying, I'm not concerned with what might happen before, except to be really watching now with 5 months left to go. We are watching with eyes peeled for things that would give us little notes and signs, or maybe something very clearly signs, to let us know that truly this is the year of 2024. Outside of the rest of the stuff that we've already built on earlier, showing 2024. So if this is indeed the case, and the veil gets lifted when he returns, what does atonement, the Day of Atonement, have to do with this wedding period of time at the end of the 14th year? Well, let's bring it home with this.
Going to be blessed. You see, some people, most people don't know. Strangely, Yom Kippur has a link in Jewish tradition to a wedding, to the Hebrew marriage. In fact, sometimes bride and grooms fast on the day of your prayer, and they wear white. You wear white on Yom Kippur. Well, on one hand, the Day of Atonement is about coming together. It's about man and God coming together. That's like a marriage. But also, what happens on Yom Kippur that happens on the wedding? The veil is removed. The bride.
Oh, do I rest my case? Do I rest my case? Brothers and sisters, the 14 years begins and ends and throughout on the Feast of Trumpets. The final years, Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of Trumpets, and 10 days to Yom Kippur and the veil finally lifting. The story's over. The revelation is revealed. You understand why for the last year I've understood it. I've been at peace. I thought it was going to bring a lot more people at peace. Knowing this period of time, and just because we know and understand this period of time, doesn't mean we have the right to say, oh, I'm going to go do this and do that. Oh, I'll read scripture sometimes. Oh, when the date approaches, then I'll spend more time. No. For me, it freed me to focus on the rest of the revelation and where the Lord leads. As it should with all of us, to be able to breathe and to enjoy things that he's given us in this period of time that we're in, to be prepared and to ready ourselves and to be strengthened. Not to just, you know, that's the last thing I want to do. The last thing I want is for people to understand it so clearly so that they could think, oh, I'm going to go chill and do whatever I want and I'll come back later. That's the worst thing to do. If this really is the year as it appears it is based on everything revealed, this is all the more time to dig in and draw closer, because the enemy is only going to increase his power and authority. He's only going to get stronger and stronger. What do you think that means if you're the one walking away or saying, oh, I'll come back later? The enemy's already got his grips on you. You think you're just going to suddenly want to come back and you're going to be all gung-ho? No, the enemy will try to keep those grips in you even longer. Now more than ever is to turn to him, be strengthened in him, be repentant, help people, lift up people, support, pray for everybody. Do everything we should be doing to the best of our ability. Of course, we'll stumble and fall sometimes. But we have our Lord and Savior to turn to in those times, to forgive us of our sins, to strengthen us. Don't let this be an excuse to chill until then. Let this be a time to free your mind from always being on edge of when it's going to happen and just be ready and remain ready always until. Enjoy things. Go maybe a little here, do a little there, but do it in the love, in the thankfulness, in joy, and in seeking him along the way. You don't have to take a pull back or do any of that stuff. Be strengthened, guys. We only have about 5 months. Here we are, the 9th of September right now. The 9th of September. We're talking 5 months. We can endure that no problem. So let's keep doing it together, brothers and sisters. Let's keep strengthening each other, picking each other up, doing what we can, and let's help our brothers and sisters reach as many more people as we can in salvation and in readiness. I love you guys. God bless you. I pray this has blessed you and strengthened you. We'll talk to you soon. And now you can see why I was so excited. We'll talk to you soon. God bless you. Bye for now.